is your humble servant Squint, back with more Let's Play Demon's Souls. I did a little bit of rejiggering in between missions here, in between updates. I went ahead and put on my light armor. I'm gonna outfit myself with this pickaxe for the next area. And I also went ahead and traded in my brass telescope for this item. The Fragrant Ring. This is the MP equivalent of the Regenerator's Ring. It recovers magic points gradually over time, as long as we have it equipped. I got this by trading the brass telescope at the Crow Tree. You just drop the brass telescope and the crows give you this ring. It's a pretty nice ring. There's a few ways to get it in the game. This is one of three ways that I'm aware of. Let's spend some souls to level up. Just barely don't have enough souls to put 2 points down, so I'm just going to upgrade my hit points a little bit. And I think after this I'll probably upgrade endurance. But as I said, just barely not enough. Let's go see what else has changed in the Nexus.
What? You again? The disciples and the magicians in the Nexus despise one another. Did you notice they never sit in sight of each other? The fools. What good comes of childish rivalries? We are all prisoners here.
Well, this guy's outlook is definitely taking a turn for the bleak, but he does have a point. And speaking of disciples, we have a new miracle fellow over here on the god side of the Nexus.
May the heavens umb.
Okay, she said everything she's gonna say. Here he is.
Thanks to you, I was able to seek refuge in this Nexus. Now I stay here and pray, along with my disciples, for the heroes facing the demons. If you wish for benevolent protection in your fight against the demons, then bring me demon souls. I will cleanse them and perform a miracle with their power.
Saint Urbane is the go-to miracle guy. He can use demon souls to give us powerful miracles. Here's slow recovery that we can use with the Adjudicator's Soul. It's basically the effect of the Adjudicator's Shield in miracle form. It's not all that useful. Everybody and their brother uses the Adjudicator's Soul for the meat cleaver. One-time revival, it's kind of interesting, but the real score here is anti-magic field, which most people consider to be absolutely essential. And for me in particular, it's useful for one encounter that I can think of that I'll tell you about, well, later on. But we'll probably be getting anti-magic field.
If you truly are a disciple, then you must have a talisman in God's image. Heavenly miracles occur in Boletaria through the talismans. God has granted this accursed land with a special power. It is God's way of telling us we must stand up to the demons. Yes, I see. I certainly cannot force you to do anything. But you must remember this. A demon soul is a source of evil power.
So that's Saint Urbane. This fella has something new to say.
My, you have rescued the Honorable One. I express my deepest gratitude. You have relieved me of a great onus. Oh, thank God. I'm better.
Okay, quick note about one-time revival for those of you curious. If you cast one-time revival on yourself and then you die and the death is not from just falling to your death, you are revived at the spot you died with 50% of your maximum hit points, which is pretty cool, but it's not as cool as the other thing you can get for the old hero's soul, and that's the weapon. I've never really used one-time revival personally. I've always gotten the weapon instead. So here we are back in Stonefang Tunnel. As I said, I've equipped myself with the pickaxe to show off its unique property of being able to deal stabbing damage with the swing. I'll just watch this little fella roll downhill, because it's fun. I'll gather up his splinter of sharpstone. We're going to get a lot of ores on this run, because this first area is meant to load you down with ores so that you get comfortable with the upgrade, the weapon upgrade system. So that's all there is down there. But since we have our shortcut unlocked, we can now take it and get back to the fog door we haven't gone through yet. Everybody off. Man, it's dark in here. Now you notice the there are fewer of these golem guys, or whatever they are, than before. That's because the golems with the sacks do not respawn. Once you kill them and they give up their ore, they don't reappear in the game world like the other regular golems do. Let these guys figure out what they're doing. Notice how my swings do a lot more damage than they would if I was using a cutting weapon. So that's what the pickaxe does for us. Aside from this, though, it's not a spectacular weapon. It can't even one-shot these guys on a backstab, so... Mostly it's just so that I don't have to keep using strong attacks over and over. That was a dirty trick. I should have remembered that. Now, spear also works really well against these guys, but we haven't gotten one yet. We'll get one when we go back to Boletarian Palace. With regards to storing this weapon, it's actually classified as a mace, which I think is kind of interesting. When you go to store it with Stockpile Thomas, It's under the mace section. I guess that's because it's kind of hard to classify as a weapon. Nothing else really has the same properties as the pickaxe. Although it does have the mace's attack pattern. It's kind of a diagonal across the body attack. Large splinter of hard stone. Okay, we're in the big open area that you probably are familiar with. There's a crystal gecko around the corner, but we're not going to go that way just yet. First, I'm going to break through these explodable barrels and head upstairs. Off in the distance, there are two, they look like kilns, which is used to heat and shape the ore. I went this way because there's a couple of items up here that you can only get to through this method, and here's the second one. And another benefit of doing this is that you start out behind all of these golems that are waiting around the corner for you, which is why we didn't go tearing around that corner after the crystal gecko, because it's supposed to lure you into all these guys, and then they ruin your day. Now, the item I just picked up back there is a steel shield, and it's classified as a heavy shield, which means that it's not as maneuverable as the heater shield. Although it does provide superior protection, however, I kind of like the light armor setup I'm using right now to get my stamina back quickly, and I I'm able to sprint longer distances, and I get the fast roll. Now, the steel shield would cut into that. Now you can see how useful the pickaxe is here. I don't have to worry about wasting time lining up strong attacks. I can just kind of hack away at these guys with my regular attacks. So, they took a chunk out of us, but we survived. That's always important. Now that that little cart there is the only thing that prevented that crystal gecko from going over the edge. So we're able to kill it, and we get a new type of ore, the Spider Stone. The Spider Stone is used to upgrade bows, and only bows. It's the only type of ore that bows can use, and only bows can use the ore, so that's pretty much your only, the only game in town for upgrading bows. So before I move on, I'm going to show you one last thing, which is a cluster of items over there. This little bridge here is misleading. You have to actually sprint across. If you don't sprint, you'll fall down like that. So that's how you get across there. You get a great club, which is the two-handed version of the club that the barbarian class starts out with. The barbarian class starts out with a club, a shield, a lot of strength, and no armor. The great club is an upgrade. So I'm going to do a cut here, because we're back in a familiar area, and that's the only way to get back to where we were. So here we are back, where we move on. And there's the pit of lava down there, if you remember that. So now we're moving up to the kilns, and these salamanders are hanging out on the outer wall of the kilns, because I guess it's hot. And they like the heat. Now the strong attack for mace weapons and for the pickaxe is completely vertical. And it's handy on very short enemies like these. However, we're going to have to do some fast attacks if we want to stay ahead of these guys. Dogs and the salamanders have some fast attacks, but fortunately the attacks don't take off that much damage, so we're able to withstand it. So you gotta be careful as you're walking along the outside of these things. You gotta make sure that no salamanders are gonna drop down on you. One last fella to go. In the next area, fire defense will be an extremely important asset to us, so we're going to have to prepare ourselves for the second area of Stonefang Tunnel after this, because salamanders are just the beginning. Got a couple more dogs waiting for us down here. Yeah, they get some cheap shots in, but they only take away a sliver of health, so it's not such a big deal. One thing to make up for that, as you can see, is their ability to do attacks in rapid succession. So I guess there's that. We get a couple more grindstones. I don't really use them personally, because I have a habit of repairing all my stuff before I head out, but it's good to have one or two for emergencies, or in certain areas of the game where you're up against guys with acid attacks. It'd be good to have some grindstones then, but they can only be used on weapons. And shields. Whatever you have equipped in your right hand will get repaired by the grindstone. Got some more miners down here. Attracted the attention of several of them, so I'm going to do a little withdrawal here so I can line them up better. You don't want them surrounding you. That's a recipe for disaster. There's one over there who's not moving, and there's the guy with the sack here. I'm gonna kill him. Take his ore. This guy seems to have been guarding the mechanism on the wall to the right there. I actually meant to pick up the ore, but I went ahead and turned the handle anyway. But we were going to do that second, so it doesn't really matter that much. And with that, the lava pit is cooled, and we are now able to walk across it. And we get all the yummy ore there from that guy with the sack. And before I head out, I'll just do a quick check for items. All good over there. Nothing over here. Okay, we're ready to head back. Now for a shortcut, you just kind of walk off the ledge there, and you're back near the lava that you have to go across. Well, I guess it's not lava anymore, is it? It's just stone. Here we are. There's the water pouring down there, and now we can see that there are a couple of items waiting for us. And there's one well-hidden item off to the left here that most people forget about. The Ring of Poison Resistance. I'm going to go ahead and let you guess what that does. It can be useful later on. Useful enough to take up a ring slot, at least temporarily. So now we're on to a new section, littered with corpses of creatures we killed up above. All those dogs and salamanders you saw that were already dead fell down from higher levels. So I'm just scanning here, making sure there's nothing waiting in the dark for me, because the game really is as dark as it looks on the video. The light we have does not reach very far. So there's a minister between us and the next fog door, and he's in a room full of exploding barrels. That's bad news for us. We're gonna have to get rid of as many as possible before he can use his fireball attacks on them. Okay, so the pickaxe is not doing a whole hell of a lot to him, so let's speed this along. We get completely destroyed by exploding barrels. Almost took me out. Fortunately, we just put some points into vitality, so that helped us out. It was a close call, but we came out on top. Let this be a lesson to you. Exploding barrels are bad news. Now the effects of the Crescent Falchion and the Fragrant Ring do stack, so we can get our magic points back twice as fast if we have both equipped. The Stone of Ephemeral Eyes will be useful for me for grinding Black World Tendency. How I do that is, After I clear a world, and after I get the White World tendency, I can then use the Stones of Ephemeral Eyes to commit suicide constantly and keep giving myself a new physical body. And what that does is it turns the world tendency towards the black. And offline, that's pretty much the best way to do it. It's kind of gamey, but it's safe, it's easy, and it's surefire. Of course, if you run low on Stones of Ephemeral Eyes, you have to find a different way of doing it. So I'm going to be using those as rarely as I can, because I really want to stock up on them. This area right here is devoid of enemies, but there is an item to be had. There's a little break in the corner here, so we do a little jump, just to be safe. And we get the Chris Knife. Let's have a look at it. A 62 magic attack, but we don't have enough magic stat to use it, which is fine. The main purpose of this weapon is actually to be held in the offhand while you cast magic spells with a catalyst. It increases magic damage or magic effectiveness, but it also decreases magic defense, as you can see on the right there. It lowers magic defense while you have it out. So it's a purely spellcaster weapon. We're not really interested in it at all with our melee-centered build. So down we go. We're heading deeper and deeper into Stonefang now. Coming up is the end of the mines area. Then we get into more of the tunnels area. And as you can probably see, that big fog door means that there's a boss on the other side. I get this chunk of spider stone here, and then I remember an item that I missed back up at the top of the elevator. So I do a little cut right here to spare you the elevator ride of going back up. And I run over and get the item, which is more spider stone. And then I head back. And another snip here to spare you the elevator ride back down. And with that done, now I head through the fog door and we encounter the first boss of Stonefang Tunnel. The Armor Spider. This is his first attack, the web. I'm now not able to run or dodge. It's a very effective 1-2 punch he has. If he hits you with the web, and you're a sitting duck for his fireball attacks. And as you can see there, I can't even shield block it. You have to dodge the web. Otherwise, you're going to get a face full of fireball. Not a very good start for me here. I'm trying to get close to him, but he's just spamming fireballs at me. This right here is his ultimate screw you attack. It's a cone of fire that goes most of the way down the tunnel. You have to go all the way to the back if you want to avoid being hit by it. It's his most powerful attack too. Fortunately, the charge up time is very long, so you can see it coming. Here's his melee attack. It's not very dangerous. It looks frightening, but it really doesn't do that much damage. And it's easy to shield block. See, even though it hit me, it didn't do that much damage. Now, meleeers like it when he does that shaking and falling down thing, because he's a sitting duck for attacks then. And here is the worst possible thing that can happen to you when facing the Armor Spider. It's being webbed, and then being in the cone of fire. And how you deal with it is you just have to ride it out as long as you possibly can by rolling backwards away from the fire, and hoping that it doesn't catch you enough times to kill you. All things considered, that was a lot less worse than it could have been. And I don't feel that I got hit by that particular web attack, but the game once again decided that I did. And I get up just in time to be webbed again, so I get hit by another fireball. My problem is that I was dodging way too soon. I was actually reacting too quickly to his attacks. When he rears up like that, that's meant to be a telegraph, but if you do it too fast, you'll be coming out of your roll just in time to get hit by the web. Right there, I was expecting a melee attack, but he did a fireball instead. I switched away from the pickaxe because it wasn't doing hardly any damage to him. My Crescent Falchion has magic damage to boot, so it helps out a lot. In my opinion, the Armor Spider is one of the more difficult Stage 1 bosses. Mostly because he has a good variety of ranged attacks, and it's hard to get close to him. So half of the battle is just getting close enough to him to do damage if you're going pure melee. It's a lot easier for magic and ranged people. But I like melee. Melee is fun. And nobody wants to see me hang off to the side and just shoot a million arrows into him. Just take that one on the chin and keep on swinging. And the armor spider is dead. That was a fun battle. Had a rocky start, but I managed to finally get in there. There's a couple items in here. Nothing super special, but you want to be thorough. Get some more spider stone. And I think that'll do it for items. Yep. Okay, the only thing left to do is hit the Archstone and see what we get. We get a hard demon soul and pure spider stone, which is the ore needed to upgrade a bow to its highest level. We only get one per game, and that's the one we get. So that was stage 1 of Stonefang Tunnel. Join me next time on Let's Play Demon Souls.